And of course, there was the usual lip service paid to Skill India, Digital India, and Startup India, but no mention of Standup India, since you're so busy banning stand-up comedians. And no admission that your government's scheme should really be renamed Sit Down India, Shutdown India, and Shut Up India.
Shame, shame.
To take just one example, Mr. Chairman, this government holds the world record for the largest number of internet shutdowns, and in Jammu and Kashmir, the longest communications blockade and internet suspension of any country in the world. Now, frankly, sir, the president was required to make extravagant claims about various government schemes in health and women's security, manufacturing, agriculture, fisheries, which are belied by official available facts and figures. There was absolutely no acknowledgement of the failure to achieve targets. There was no achievement, no acknowledgement of the 27 protesters killed by the police, the mounting non-performing assets, the record pollution levels in our air and our water, the increasing assaults on women, the complete neglect of fisher folk and coastal communities. Frankly, they are people devastated by natural calamities, hurricanes, floods, coastal erosion, and of course, depleting fish stocks, and the government just randomly announces a target that bears no relation to reality and makes the president utter it. Then the prolonged detention of political leaders in Jammu and Kashmir, not mentioned. The dramatic increase in the number of infiltrations across the LOC since the 5th of August. Government figures not mentioned by the president. Fact is, everything from the decrease in defense allocations we heard from the finance minister, which are not even enough to match the rate of inflation. There's so many examples of poor governance by this government in the last year that it is very clear that their clarion call, recently quoted by an ally of theirs, of Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas, Sabka Vishwas, honestly reminds me of what Napoleon said about the Holy Roman Empire, that it was neither holy nor Roman nor an empire. Na Sabka Saath hai, na Vikas hai, na Vishwas hai. All of these aspects pale in comparison with the larger crisis that is holding hostage the future of the India we cherish. In these last few months, under this government, we have witnessed a fundamental assault on the democratic, secular, and constitutional fabric of India that our forefathers, giants like Mahatma Gandhiji, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, Dr. Ambedkar, Maulana Azad, and so many other giants of the independence movement gave their lives for. Even as they've driven the economy into the doldrums, the present ruling dispensation has become a tukde-tukde gang. Yeah. They are dividing this country into tukde, Hindus versus Muslims, Deshdrohis versus Deshbhakts, Ramzade versus, main bolunga nahi, Hindus versus Muslims, Hindi speakers versus non-Hindi speakers, us versus them. In 1947, Mr. Chair, we had a partition of the Indian soil. In 2020, this government is giving us a partition of the Indian soul. Just starting with what has happened within the walls of this House, with the passing of far-reaching legislation, such as the disemboweling of the RTI Act, the UAPA Bill with its draconian measures, the Jammu and Kashmir Reorganization Bill, the CAA, plus the declared intention by the Home Minister to launch a nationwide NRC, and of course, the statements made by the ruling party's members outside the House, which I will not quote because they would demean the dignity of this House. We are facing an existential threat to the future of our democracy and the freedoms that we have taken for granted since our independence from colonial rule over 75 years ago. To you, that is the old India, and you want in its place to replace it with a hollow facade that you have dubbed the new India. In the old India, fought for by the blood of our forefathers, birthed in the crucible of our national struggle, the fundamental premise that was ultimately forged was that of access to a historically inalienable set of rights and freedoms. Prime was the freedom to choose what government you wanted, the freedom to choose what set of convictions to have, the freedom to choose what to wear, what to eat, what to drink, to speak, the freedom to move freely within the sovereign borders of our republic, and the freedom to choose how and in what manner you would bow your head before your understanding of the force that guides the cosmos. All of these were freedoms enshrined in our Constitution and embedded not just in the letter of the law, but in the spirit of the Constitution and in the lived experience of India and its people. It is lamentable that those who followed us in government have not had the capacity, the vision, or the inclination to uphold this timeless legacy. Instead, in today's times, that vision of India is questioned by rising intolerance, in which the forces unleashed by our present rulers have appropriated the tools of the state to marginalize and exclude. Though their language is modern, they seek to take India backward, not forward. After all, they made no sacrifices to shape India's destiny. And for them, our country is a plaything for the satisfaction of personal glories, for their narrow-minded ideology and their communal prejudices. Their modern jargon conceals pre-modern beliefs, Mr. Chairperson. And it is our duty in the opposition to pull away the hypocrisy and reveal the darkness lurking beneath. It was appalling and distressing to see this government actually make the president selectively quote the father of our nation, Mahatma Gandhiji, whose ideals they have willfully disregarded in an attempt to legitimize the desecration of the very national unity that Mahatma Gandhi gave his life for. The president's address quoted that the Mahatma said, Hindus and Sikhs of Pakistan who do not wish to live there can come to India. It is a duty of the government of India to ensure a normal life for them. No one disagrees with that. Congress Party supports that fully. But this quote was then used to make the absurd claim that the draconian censorship citizenship amendment was a fulfillment of the Mahatma's wishes. Now, by reproducing a line without its context, not only has the government misled the Rashtrapati about the Rashtrapita, but they have attempted yet another affront to a man who spent his lifetime advocating Hindu-Muslim unity, a man who fought till the very end to resist the idea that religion should determine nationhood, which is sadly the idea they have embraced. Frankly, sir, the president should have continued to quote Mahatma Gandhiji's words. He has said at the same time, to drive every Muslim from India would mean war and eternal ruin for the country. If such a suicidal policy is followed, it would spell the ruin of Hinduism in the Union. Good alone can beget good, Mahatma Gandhi said. Love breeds love. As for revenge, it behooves man to leave the evildoer in God's hands. The idea that India should only belong to Hindus is wrong. That way lies destruction. Destruction is the path you want to take us on. I'm anguished as I say these words, Mr. Chairman. Guided by the Mahatma, we in the Congress Party have historically committed ourselves to sustaining an idea of India that is fundamentally different from the thinking of those who rule us today. In keeping with that heritage, we are proud descendants of that heritage. Let me remind my friends and colleagues in the House, amidst these sobering times, it's easy to forget the value of ideas and our responsibility to commit ourselves to the power of ideas. But ideas are powerful. Ideas speak truth to power. They challenge the status quo. And ultimately, ideas have been responsible for taking our country out of darkness before and to a position of pride and greatness in the world, which is now sadly eroding under your rule. In these times, let us remember that our first Prime Minister, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, memorably noted, failure comes only when we forget our ideals and objectives and principles. This is why we in the Congress have always believed in an idea of India where the first and the last voice, the ones that resonate loudly and the ones that have been marginalized and discriminated against, are both equally important in determining the future of the country. We are the only party that has historically championed the principle that India is a land that belongs to all Indians, irrespective of caste, religion, region, language, socioeconomic status. Inclusive India for us is more than just a slogan. It is an aspiration, an objective, and a commitment. After all, as Nehruji also wrote, idealism is tomorrow's realism. It is our duty, even in this dark hour, to keep alive the flame of our national idealism. If we accept without scrutiny, without question, without challenge, the fallacies and follies of today's short-sighted and narrow-minded leaders, we will leave for our children a land of injustice, a legacy of trauma, and a country divided and broken. We have daunting battles to fight, Mr. Chairperson, against poverty, against malnutrition, against bigotry, against patriarchy, against illiteracy, against discrimination. But we must prevail in this greater struggle for the soul and the spirit of our nation. If the government continues down this very slippery slope, no matter how many leaders from history you borrow or whose name you seek to hijack, you will be exposed and history will see you for what you really are, men of straw with limited vision, unable to comprehend the great, diverse, united society you are meant to govern, not to divide and break up. What we want in India is unity. You want uniformity. We believe in an India that unites our people. You seek to divide us. We seek to promote consensus. You demand conformity. Our ideology binds the people of India together. Yours separates one Indian from another. What we need in our new India is the strengthening of democracy and democratic institutions at all levels. We need transparency and accountability of this government enforced through the Right to Information Act, which they've hollowed out, and an active parliament, a courageous parliament. You seek to weaken these institutions, yes, to hollow out RTI, yes, to disregard, yes, parliament, which has become a notice board for the BJP, and to promote one man or two man rule. Our new India must derive its support and strength from all sections of our diverse society. Your new India rests on one faith and reduces others to second-class status. The choice is clear, my dear colleagues. We can either have a new India that belongs to all of us, led by a government that works for all of us, or we can have a new India that belongs to some and serves the interests of a few. You can choose a new India that embodies hope or one that promotes fear. You can support a new India united in striving or an India divided by hatred. 1 minute, sir. What we need is an India whose progress takes place in an open society, in a rich and diverse and plural civilization, in one that's open to the contention of ideas and interests within it, which is unafraid of the prowess or the products of the outside world, but which is wedded to the democratic pluralism that is India's greatest strength, and determined to liberate and fulfill the creative energies of its people. The President's address, sadly, fails to live up to these national aspirations, and therefore I regret that we must reject this motion of thanks. Jai Hind. Thank you.